Macmillan Audio presents Deconstructing, written and read by Karla Kamstra. She said, "What does it mean to be an ordained elder for the Presbyterian Church?" I said, "Well, Grandma, it means I'm chosen to help lead and shepherd the congregation." Pause. I said, "What do you think of that?" She said, "Well, as long as it brings you closer to God." She let that sentence hang there, because that was the space between her generation and mine, between her beliefs and mine. She's long gone, but that sentence still holds meaning for me and my journey of deconstructing, leaving church, and finding my faith, because this journey has indeed brought me closer to God, and somehow, some way, she knows that. This book is in honor of the grandmother who planted the seed of spirituality in my life. She is the reason you are reading this book. I'm forever grateful. Introduction. How did I end up here? Beloved, you are not alone. If you found your way here because you are untangling from your indoctrinated religious beliefs, those words may do little to comfort you. Rest assured, I understand this. I have been right where you are. I wanted to believe that others would arrive to help me on this healing journey to reclaim my spirituality and to heal what organized religion had taken from me. I wanted to believe that others understood and that I was not alone. Except I was alone. I was facing the stark reality that nothing about my life inside church prepared me for life outside of it. Of course, it wouldn't have. Church needed me to stay rooted inside its structure, obedient to its dogma, and submissive to its authority. Its own survival depended on that. A member who will not submit to this structure is a threat to it. There is no compromise. Submit or leave. I left. Yes, this was the loneliness of my own doing. I had the choice to stay, faking it in the pews by spiritually checking out. I had witnessed people who had done that for many years, so why couldn't I? Why wasn't it enough for me to be the good Christian? A phrase that was never used but fundamentally understood to mean be silent, obedient, and never, ever challenge church authority. Why couldn't I just show up to church, study my Bible, pay my tithe, raise my hands in praise at the appropriate time, and then go home until next Sunday? That's Christianity on autopilot. Lather, rinse, repeat. This may work for some, but not for me. It simply wasn't in my DNA to be that type of Christian. What wasn't clear then, but would eventually become clear to me, was that I myself was not the problem. It was the church's rules that dictated what it meant to be a good Christian that were the problem. The rules. Some may call it dogma, others theology. Whatever you call it, it always felt restrictive. Those rules felt like they kept God in a box that was too small. And I had literally spent a lifetime trying to contort myself and become small enough to fit into that box as well. It was as suffocating as it sounds, and I finally realized that it was this God box from which I needed to escape. It was time to release God from those rules. This book will share my journey from silent obedience to living a spiritually empowered life. Those are the bookends, and a lifetime of wisdom, heartache, wonder, and surprise are contained herein. Beloved, what about you? Do you feel a deep void that church can no longer fill? An emptiness in your heart and soul that simply will not abate no matter what you do? Even if you have go-to spiritual practices of prayer, meditation, journaling, and the like, you can't shake the lingering sense that something is still missing from your life. I've been there. For years, I felt an emptiness in my heart and soul, a spiritual unrest that I couldn't explain. When I tried to pinpoint the source of it, I always fell short. It frustrated me and convinced me that there was something wrong with my spirituality. But I really tried. Can you relate? I attended church. I listened intently to every word the pastor said. I overcommitted to activities and functions. I dove into my spiritual practices, seeking meaning and clarity for what I was feeling. And still, the need for something else would not leave my soul. As I continued to struggle with the changes arising in me, I began to sense that my spiritual unrest was not going to go away until I discovered where it was coming from and what it meant for me outside of the Christianity I knew. At first, the thought of moving away from my spiritual community to try to figure out what was happening terrified me. I was battling a lifetime of religious indoctrination that taught me that seeking answers outside church was dangerous and sinful. To do so literally meant my soul would be in peril. I was told the Bible held all the answers to life's questions, and if I wasn't clear about it, the next step was to ask my pastors. The practice of seeking wisdom first from the Bible and then from your pastor is common within evangelical or fundamentalist Christianity. While it can be helpful for people needing advice on issues of religion, I have witnessed and experienced for myself congregants being accused of weak faith for even acknowledging their internal stirrings. We were told we had doubters' minds. I have also seen the dark side of this belief system, where pastors inappropriately attempt to fill roles that belong to qualified therapists. I have heard them dismiss issues of mental health and admonish women for considering divorce from abusive husbands. I have even listened as young women shared their heartbreak for being told they weren't allowed to date other members of the church because the pastor didn't approve of these relationships. This is the same mentality and religious ideology I've seen speak of praying the gay away. Admittedly, my experience may shock some of you as you read about the depths of control and manipulation tactics utilized by church authorities to control their flock. Then again, some of you may find it mild compared to your own experience. Christian doctrine varies so greatly that a Presbyterian and a Westboro Baptist Church goer, both Christians, would be equally aghast at the other's services. Even in congregations that seem more open-minded or progressive, you may find yourself hesitant to share your feelings with anyone in your community. Within each denomination are unspoken membership rules that many fear breaking, lest they're seen as lacking faith or, even worse, fear repercussions for challenging the patriarchal structure upon which Christianity is built. Still, the sheer number of people who are leaving Christianity indicates that many are like me, ready to answer the call to reclaim their spirituality outside the construct of their religious heritage. According to the data, for the first time in U.S. history, church membership has fallen below 50% and continues to decline. This indicates that we are no longer a Christian nation. I have the gift of hindsight, which shows me that the best thing I ever did for my spiritual journey was listen to my inner voice that beckoned me to dive into the unrest I was feeling. I began to covertly seek out other wisdom keepers whose teachings differed from the Christian theology I had known my entire life. As I studied and learned from these scholars, my feelings vacillated between relief, anger, confusion, fear, and clarity. I soaked up knowledge from teachers of many different backgrounds and beliefs. With each book I read and lecture I attended came new concepts that I had never heard before, challenging me, yet enriching and expanding my understanding of human spirituality. Little by little, my spiritual unrest began to point me to my eventual path out of church as I increasingly came to rely on and identify with readings and teachings outside my Christian heritage. It was an interesting season, to say the least. I continued to wear the facade of the good Christian and kept to myself the things I was learning, the additional text put in the Bible to change the original meaning, Christianity's dark history surrounding its use of torture and abuse as a way to control the masses, and most importantly, I witnessed the way people around the world sought sacred meaning in their lives by honoring the divine in ways that reflected their own traditions and cultures. Still, off to church, I would go to sing hymns of praise while secretly longing to return home and dive into the latest book by Bishop John Shelby Spong and other similar authors. In other words, I was living a paradox, which for me meant that I was living two contradictory experiences at the same time. This was one of many paradoxes to come, and they had no end in sight, at least at that time. I couldn't see what my future in church looked like. I would experience similar things throughout my journey. I entered the spiritual wilderness, a concept I'll explain in chapter one. Untangled from beliefs inside my Christian faith that had become a weapon of control instead of a source of inspiration. I healed my religious trauma and reclaimed my spirituality. And I now live a spiritually empowered life as a transformed, unchurched, non-conforming Christian who honors the spiritual but not religious path. Does this paradox sound familiar, beloved? Do you find it difficult to describe what you are experiencing? That is not uncommon, because you have never been here before. Faith was most likely a stalwart, a shelter in a time of storm, so steadfast and reliable that it was the one thing you could lean on, until one day you simply couldn't. Why? Because something shifted deep inside you, and there is no denying its presence, its pull, and the longing to discover its mysteries. May I offer you some loving, gentle insight? It may be challenging to do so, but trust this process of deconstructing, because this is indeed a sacred journey in which you are about to partake. You are answering the call to demolish the structure upon which your faith has been built. Repair what religion may have done to you, and restore your heart and soul in a way that is authentically you. Demolish, repair, restore. These are what I believe are the steps to deconstructing one's faith. When you first begin the deconstructing journey, the process by which you untangle from the elements of your Christian heritage that have harmed you or no longer serve your highest good, it is not uncommon to sense a season of chaos in which the absence of religious structure feels messy and yet comforting. The void left by your spiritual community feels lonely yet peaceful. The lack of spiritual guidance from a church leader mandating how to be spiritual feels unsettling yet empowering. And the loss of the container that held your spirituality leaves you feeling vulnerable yet freed. Yes, beloved, demolish, repair, restore. There are two significant things to remember as you begin this journey of deconstructing. The first is this: like anything in life that deals with profound change and paradigm shifts, this deconstructing process of demolishing, repairing, and restoring is not linear. You may spend months deconstructing what you learned in Bible school, Then skip right to immersing yourself into teachings about Christian mysticism or other world religions, only to find yourself spiraling into anger as you begin to realize how much you have been emotionally and spiritually manipulated throughout your life. Or you may have a completely different process. The second is that the deconstructing process doesn't have a timeline. I'm often asked by my followers how long they will be deconstructing. They're asking because this process can be challenging. It's life-changing. It rips the blinders off your reality. It shakes your foundational beliefs, and it often leaves you with the stark reality that those within your innermost circle should not be there. In other words, you come face to face with your true self without the cloak of religious beliefs protecting you. And that can be intimidating and downright scary. I'm very sincere when I reply to those questions by saying that I do.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.